Very good morning, friends. I've been asked to talk about the National Digital Communication Policy and what are the regulatory imperatives of that policy. So one is, I'll begin by saying that the recent development in technology, as also in the business, have changed the landscape of telecommunication all around the world. As I always say, telecommunication is no more a vertical, no more catering to one particular sector which is communicating with each other. Telecom is now going to become an extremely important platform. You already see in our own country the kind of digital infrastructure which has been put in place under the Digital India program. And it is very well articulated program which talks of the digital infrastructure as utility to citizens. It talks of software and services on top of that. And it also certainly talks of the citizens' empowerment to leverage and utilize the digital infrastructure. And we have put together a number of platforms, which is identity platform, payment platform, and other, you know, artifacts which are actually promoting the digital transactions throughout the country. Talk of, just take one sector, payments. Now the total number of transactions in unified payment transactions, UPI, their numbers has gone up to 700 million transactions per month. Now, you know, this is a huge number, and this number surpasses by a factor of two or three the total number of credit card transactions or debit card transactions which happen in this country. And as you know, debit card and credit cards have been happening since last 40 years or 30 years. So this is the scale, this is the speed. And why does it happen? It happens because what I call three C's, which is the cost, convenience, and confidence. And confidence could be easily said to be trust. So slowly and slowly, people are developing trust in the technology. People are finding it very, very convenient. The other day, I had to transfer money to somebody. So if I would have gone to the, you know, my bank, even digital, that is also digital, but if I would have gone to my bank's website and then created a payee, so to say, of an individual, and then waited for 24 hours to pay the money, because they activate, there is a certain minimum amount of time which is required, and it varies from bank to bank. So in my bank, it was 24 hours. So even when it is called IMPS, immediate payment whatever system, it could have taken a minimum 24 hours for me to transfer money to an individual. Now, I went to the UPI. The individual provided me what is called the virtual payment address, which is doesn't disclose anything about his bank account, even probably his bank. Of course, the VPA in that case included his bank ID, but that's not really required. So he just did that, and I was able to pay the money in just a matter of 1 minute. So people find these technologies and these use cases extremely fast, extremely cost-effective, because even in IMPS or NEFT, I pay 2.5 rupees to 5 rupees per transaction. On the other hand, these UPI guys, they even, you know, reward me something if I use their platform. So that ecosystem has been created in our country, which is actually accelerating these transactions beyond anybody's imagination. So this is what is happening. Today, a kind of revolution is happening in the digital world. So in terms of application, and you know, people used to think, oh, who will do digital payments? People who are very, you know, tech-savvy, only they will do. But if we take this 600 or 700 million transactions per day, I don't think you have that many tax-savvy people only who are doing these transactions. These transactions are being done by normal, ordinary people who are not that tax-savvy. And they are able to do it because this whole platform is friendly, convenient, and cost-effective, and of course it provides them confidence. So this is the architecture which has been built in our country to essentially leverage all the, you know, technology developments which are taking place, and this is going to spread to almost every area of the country. With the advent of 5G, it's going to happen, and it's going to become very, very ubiquitous. So what is required actually is, for all this to happen, you require an ubiquitous, robust, reliable, cost-effective connectivity. Because that's the basic. Without that, you don't, you know, have any of these things. And while we have, during the past years, we have now, our networks are delivering data, which is you know, many times more than the data. And I'm told it is about 13 or 14 times in the last couple of years it has, the data delivery growth has happened. Ultimately, there are certain deficiencies in this architecture which need to be addressed. And some of the deficiencies are lack of landlines, you know, reliability in terms of assured bandwidth. Because some time back, actually, about a year back, if I'm not wrong, we, at the demand of many of our consumers, started a consultation on the issue as to whether we can ensure a minimum bandwidth delivery. And, you know, this consultation went on, and then everybody, without any exception, came back to us and said, how can you ensure delivery in terms of minimum bandwidth or minimum download speed in a wireless environment? You can't do that. You know, when you are traveling, or even when you are not traveling, the so-called laws of physics come into play, and therefore you just can't ensure a particular minimum bandwidth. So this is a problem which we have in our country, which is the lack of fixed line, you know, delivery of broadband. That, I think, has to be addressed. So what had happened is the government of India, and Aruna is here and she will probably talk more about it. Government of India really created an excellent document called National Digital Communication Policy, and it's so good that they did not call it telecom policy, because typically we have been having a multiple versions of this telecom policy. And I think the time has come, because telecom has now grown to become digital. The entire thing, you know, data has become the basic raw material. Everything else has become a product of that data. So whether it's a voice, or whether it is any of the pictures, or whatever you call, so they are all products of that data. So I think digital communication policy is the right name for it. And I think the kind of statements and the kind of aspirations which are contained in that digital communication policy are really very, very fundamental, and they do provide a very clear guideline as to where we need to proceed from here. So, you know, the three major areas which the digital policy outlines in the beginning, which is the Connect India, Propel India, and Secure India. So I think Propel India talks of building applications, doing startups, and doing other things. But I think the Connect India and the Secure India, these two parts directly relate to networks. And it very well quantifiably lays down as to what we want to achieve. So it talks about how much employment will it create, how much investment it will make. So all these, and how much contributions it should make to India's GDP. So it is a clear vision to attract investments and create jobs in the sector that will enable the three-pronged mission which I talked about, the Connect India, Propel India, and Secure India. And the policy also attempts to improve the business environment in the sector by reviewing current licensing framework and regulatory regime, introduce fiscal incentives for startups and SMEs, and rationalizing existing taxation structure, because that's one of the basic issues which has been happening. Is the industry has been saying that this industry is highly taxed. We in the past have been giving, TRAI has been giving certain suggestions, inputs, advice
to the government to rationalize the taxation structure. But now, this actually the two fundamental statements which are articulated in this industry, and they are made upfront. Normally, these are not, you know, governments generally shy away from making those very clear statements. One statement is, profit maximization is not the objective of this policy. So this says many things, you know, how we want to proceed. We don't want to maximize the profit, but we want to maximize the growth of this industry so that ultimately the effect of that will be more revenue to the government. You know, you don't have to get revenue from one particular aspect. You can get revenue, increased growth, increased investment taking place will actually create increased employment, will create increased opportunities of jobs and other things. And that in turn will bring more incomes to the government. So therefore, I think very clearly one sentence saying that profit maximization is not the objective. That's actually one of the more important features. And so what is happening is that rationalizing existing taxation structure is also one of the important part of that policy, so as to foster the creation of a healthy ecosystem for innovative and indigenous telecom equipments in the country. So I think this is also very, very important. There are many areas which are very noteworthy. One is the establishment of a clear data protection regime. How do we do that? Talking about a national fiber authority. So essentially, it is not just saying platitudes, it's not just making statements. It also indicates as to what are the mechanisms or what are the instrumentalities through which we will achieve these things. It talks of establishment of a national grid and implementing fiber first. So common duct policy, again, is creating, for example, we are having smart cities. Now, it is important that there is a common underlying communication infrastructure which should serve all the applications of smart cities. This whole approach of building infrastructure for each application is an extremely bad approach. I want to put a lighting and therefore I want to create my own communication infrastructure, smart lighting. I want to have smart meters and I want to create my own. That's not the way it is going to happen. You must create a common underlying communication infrastructure, which should be enabling plug and play, which means every application you want to ride on top of it, just plug into this infrastructure. And actually, we yesterday talked about in TRAI as to whether we should provide some roadmap to the government and to the DOT about having this common communication infrastructure, what should be the business model for it, potential, and how it can be accelerated and done. So it's very important. Only yesterday, if I am allowed to share, Aruna, yesterday we had a long discussion and we said, now we need to operationalize various parts. So in case the Department of Telecom, it'll be good because we are not setting the priority. It's the government who sets its own priority as to how, in what phases you want to implement this policy. So we yesterday decided that we will have a roadmap as to how we will provide advisories or how we provide inputs to the government to actually operationalize some parts of these policies. So actually, we are looking forward with great excitement to take steps to operationalize the policy, because I am personally and TRAI as an institution are convinced that this policy framework, the National Digital Communication Policy Framework, has really very comprehensively dealt with the growth roadmap of the digital communication infrastructure in this country. I must tell you that I have not come across even a single person who has said that this particular policy is lacking emphasis in a particular area. Talk of satellite, it has satellite. Talk of fiber, it has fiber. Talk of wireless, it has wireless. It has talks about freeing some of the bandwidth and airwaves. So I think it's a very, very comprehensive policy, and I must compliment Aruna and her team to really bring about this policy. We had provided the inputs, but ultimately it's their policy, and I'm very happy also that they built and they added very many significant things on top of whatever inputs we had provided, and that has really made it very comprehensive. So once again, I share everybody's enthusiasm here that we are going to see an extremely bright future, and especially when we are, you know, having large number of applications and platforms, and the basic architecture of those platforms promotes innovation, promotes layered innovation and unbundled innovation, and that's what is going to propel our country. Thank you very much.